What'd you see in there?
I don't know. I didn't see him. He came out of nowhere. Like I was hit by a ghost.
Ghost?
He's not right, man.
Yo, Captain.
You can't just get, not now, Landry, not now. You can't just come and take my shit over.
What's going on?
Armed robber, multiple hostages, the negotiator can't make contact.
Why aren't we going in?
Pretty sure our scene just became theirs.
You went down here 10 minutes ago. What is this? What do we do?
It's just wrong. I don't remember that.
What's all that?
We're gonna ask you to stand down. We're here in support now only.
Frank, this is some bullshit, man. Like, if it was up to me,
Hey, buddy. Take a break. Allen.
Hello. What's going on, brother?
Hey, how you doing? Happy Friday, man.
Man, happy Friday, man. I'm doing good, man.
Thanks for joining. How's everything going?
Everything is great, man. Everything. I can't complain, man. It's even in this crazy time in the world, man.
Absolutely.
It's been a good break for me. It's
absolutely a good break, man. For me. Yeah, well, absolutely. I mean, let me introduce you to my audience, dude. You're one of young Hollywood's, you know, busiest stars, man. You're an entrepreneur. You give back to the community. You know, you're starting with Jamie Foxx and Joseph Gordon-Levitt in a movie coming out next week on Netflix, Project Power, dude. You've been on Blackish. Of course, you're the assistant to Curtis. Man,
yeah.
I could spend an hour just going through your accolades, okay?
Let's not
go through them because we'll run out of time. But let me just say, man, respect with everything you've done.
Thank you.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. So, oh, and you run a record company, you know, a production company. Anyway, sorry.
Yeah. A lot of stuff. It's a lot.
Lots of stuff, man. I don't know when you sleep, but
this is why I said this break has been good for me.
Oh, Allen, that's great to hear, man. So let's start there. How has, you know, this year been for you? You've been running nonstop for a while.
Well, yeah, man. Like I said, it's the past 5 years have been was extremely busy for me. I was juggling starring on 4 shows and writing for 2 of them during that 5-year run, and I was continuing that process until quarantine hit. So this has been a good opportunity for me to rest up, kind of just consolidate all of the things that I'm doing, just for keying in on what I really want to do rather than just doing things to be doing them, just trimming the fat off of a lot of things in business and personal. So it's been what I do find great about this quarantine is that it's allowing people to actually rediscover themselves and have the opportunity to actually either work on themselves or deal with things that they haven't had to deal with because they're not distracted with the world.
True. That's true. Very well said. Good and bad. Absolutely, man.
Yeah.
Absolutely, dude. So let me talk about your early life for a second, if you will, and then we'll kind of move our way to the present. Yeah. You're a native of Rialto, California. You're raised, you know, by a single mom. You unfortunately lost your dad early on to cancer. But tell me about your mother, because she sounds like an unbelievable woman, man.
Yeah, man. She's the one that inspired me, my work ethic. I've never seen an individual work so hard for her family. It was a moment with her that would change my life. I was out in the projects with the cats around the way. They were smoking, drinking, rolling dice. I was chilling. I wasn't doing nothing. And I saw this lady walking down the alley, and I couldn't take my eye off her because she was just so exhausted. She was tired. And as she got closer, I realized it was my mother, and it broke my heart. And I was at the age of 17, and that's when I, you know, got myself out of the streets and just really just focused on acting. I cut off all my friends. Like, I did everything different after that moment. And that was in large part of just her never really showing me how hard and part of a day she would have when she walked through the door. And that takes a strong person to, you know, put on that face or put on that energy in front of me for 17 years. You know, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's a long run of me not really understanding how hard my mother worked for the family.
Wow, man. That's a crazy story, dude. And I do want to ask you, because at 21, you got a big break with one of your auditions, but from 17 to 21, how did you prepare yourself for this, like, moment? Were you reading a lot of books? Like, were you, like, reading it? Did you go to acting school? What were you doing in private, you know?
Well, 17, man, that was the year I graduated from high school at 16. And after that year from 16 to 17, that was that year that the thing with my mother happened, where the walk happened. Right. So at 17, it was I started training with my acting coach called, her name is Bobby Shaw Chance, and she birthed me as an actor. Like, she is the reason that Maldonado was Maldonado when it comes to me on that screen. She, from that point, it was basically, even after I landed Young and the Restless, I trained with her basically 3 to 4 times a week for basically 6 years straight to really hone in and get my craft in order. So it was a lot of training.
Good, man. They say you get celebrated in public for what you practice in private. So Allen Maldonado, example 1A.
You're right about that. I'm getting my dog, if you wonder where I'm going.
Oh, no. It's all good, man. It's all good. Appreciate it, dude. That's awesome.
We good. We in the home of Maldonado right now. It's real stuff.
That's awesome, dude. Okay, so we talked about Young and the Restless at 21. Yeah. Huge breakthrough, obviously. One of the biggest shows. Big deal, especially at 21, Allen. Tell us a little bit about the audition, man. Like, were you nervous? Like, did you have competition? What do you remember from that?
Man, that audition was I was a stubborn and stubborn little kid. Man, I saw no fear. I saw only ambition. And like, I was so like a lion. Like, I didn't care who was auditioning, who I was auditioning against. I was like, I knew I was better. Like, if you're going off pure talent, I was like, I'm better. I could bank on that. I work my ass off to get to a level where I know nobody's going to be able to outperform me. They may be able to do things different than me, but they won't be able to outperform me being me, you know? And I went in there and made it all the way to the screen test where I acted opposite of one of the already cast members on the show.
Yeah.
And I remember finishing and a guy came out the back and it was like, they was like, everybody in the production act like they saw a ghost. He comes out and he's like, hey, you know, my name is Bob. And, you know, I think you did an extraordinary job, man. Thank you so much. And I said, thank you. And, you know, I'm 17 years old, fresh out there. I mean, 21, fresh out, still coming out the projects. I don't know what's going on in this business.
Right.
I leave. And as I'm leaving, they're like, yo, that was Bob. I'm like, what are you talking about? Who the fuck is Bob? Like, he's like, he's basically one of the executive producers of the show. He's been on the show since the beginning. He never comes out of the office. So I'm like, oh, bet. I'm booking this role. I get a call from my manager. He's like, they didn't give you the role. I'm like, what? I'm like, what do you mean? Bob came out. Like, Bob came out. What do you mean? And he was like, well, you didn't get the part, but Bob created a role for you.
Oh, my God.
So that was what was so special about my first big break, was because it was you hear that, I guess, scenario being said by acting coaches and different things, and where it's like, you go in there, perform for your performance, because it's not about the role, because they may see something in you. They may see another role for you. So all you have to worry about is going there and doing the best that you can do as an actor. You can't worry about if they like, if you're going to get this role or not. It's about going in there and giving a great performance. And that was the beginning to my career. And that's the testament to my career, is that that's all that I've done throughout my career, is just going there. I love auditioning because I love to perform. So I go in there and I'm putting on a performance and I'm leaving it in that room. And whatever happens from it, happens from it. And a lot of times it may result to something different than what you came in there for.
Yeah.
You came, went in for a role. I was literally on television shows, and that opportunity created me as a writer, you know? So it's, again, these things, even though I've been writing since I was 17, my writing mentor is Michael Caine. He wrote all the right moves to Tom Cruise, to Southern Comfort. He was, you know, he was the man back in like the 70s and
80s.
And he discovered me in that acting class, the same acting class when I was 17. And I began writing with him since then.
Unbelievable.
So when the opportunity came to be a writer, I was already, you know, educated for the opportunity. So it's, I went in with something else. I went in as an actor. So again, you know, you can go in, and as long as you perform, give a great performance, you never know what that would lead to.
Unbelievable. Go ahead. I love it, dude. Man. I love your focus, man. I feel like, you know, like everyone was watching earlier the Chicago Bulls Michael Jordan documentary. That's how I feel like when I'm listening to you, man. It's like Michael Jordan, no bullshit. I'm gonna kill you. I'm gonna kill you.
Well, listen, that's I'm a Kobe Black Mamba
mentality,
disciple,
yeah.
Man. I'm a disciple, man. I watch everything that man did. As far as I just felt that I related to him rather than just be inspired by him. I related to him just because of the way he approached things. That's the way I approach things. And it's, you know, man, rest in peace to Kobe, man. That one hurt, man.
I was going to tell you, you know what? Instead of talking about your the drunk driving accident that someone almost freaking killed you, instead of talking about that, talk to me about Kobe, man. That was before the pandemic. Where were you?
At home, and I was texting back and forth with a friend of mine's, like, because it went to IG first. And
is that where you first saw it, on IG?
Yeah. IG went to IG first, and I was like, is this real? You know, we're going back and forth. Did you see anything on the news? And finally, it hit the news, and, man, I just broke down. I mean, I must have cried for about two, 3 days, man. Like, that was tough, man. It was, like I said, he was an inspiration for me in as far as, you know, you hear the phrase different, you know, same beast, different animal. Like, that was just – His sport was basketball. Mine's has been acting. You know what I'm saying? So, and just being an artist on that in every field inside of that, like it was tough, man. Definitely tough.
Yeah, man. It was very hard. I tell you, obviously, I'm a Miami Heat fan, right? But so he wasn't like my guy. But it was interesting that, like, when he passed, everyone, you know, he was everyone's guy. They just had not acknowledged it, like, to themselves, because he was so young, kind of, you know?
Yeah, he was young. He was, you know, he was so driven that it could be intimidating and often seen as heartless, as far as he would never put anything before his obsession, you know? Yeah. But his obsession is what inspired the world. Like, that's what's, like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah,
so that's what's interesting, you know, and just understanding how that whole thing went down, and just, man, you know, definitely condolences to the family, because I know if it's tough for me, it's got to be tough for them, you know.
Oh yeah, man. Yeah.
I've never met the man, and I'm over here crying for 3 days.
I thought it was met the man,
and I'm crying for 3 days.
Yeah, man, so absolutely.
I can imagine what they going through.
Yeah. I thought it was, just touching on that real quick, I thought it was interesting that Vanessa Bryant, she had to make this like press release saying, guys, thanks to the fans, we know you love them, we love you too, but please, like, stop making like drawings of like Kobe in the sky with the daughter and all that, because it's like fucking me up, you know?
I could imagine, you know, you can't get away from it, and you're trying to grieve and you're trying to come to peace with everything. That's got to be tough with the whole world mourning with you, that's, I'm sure that's a lot.
Sure. So, Allen, I got to tell you, I was watching some of your credits, like Judging Amy, for example, or The Shield.
Yeah.
We were watching that in the rehearsal earlier. You had a different level, man, in those. You tracked it up to 11.
Thanks.
But it coincides with those being after your accident. So I'm just curious. I was wondering if, like, okay, when you were recovering, for those that don't know, it's some drunk guy basically almost kills our guy here.
Yeah. Flew in the air, landed on my face, broke my right leg, my spine was curved. It was a real accident, yeah. And I was walking. Yeah, man. It's the crazy thing about it. That was wild is that I was never upset. Like, I was never upset about it. I've always felt like it was meant to be. The only time that I was upset was when we went to court. He didn't apologize, and that was the only thing that I was bothered and upset with. I felt that it was meant to be, and it was what I needed to for my personal growth. But overall, it was just like, man, I understand that it was a mistake. I understand that you were drunk. I understand that this was an accident, but that does not take away from the opportunity for you to know that you harmed someone.
Yeah.
And you almost killed someone, and you have no remorse for that. That's sad. I feel sad for you.
Yeah, man. But, like, tell me about, like, when you were recovering, your mental strength. Were you working on that? Because right now,
I'm saying. Like, it didn't bother me. Like, that didn't break me mentally. My body was broken, but my mind wasn't. My mind was got even stronger. My faith in God, my understanding of life, like the world, the sky is bluer, the grass is greener. You hear all those things when people speak of these near death situations. It's all true. I truly understand that tomorrow is not promised. And with that, I don't live in fear. I live in opportunity, ambition, and love because I know tomorrow's not promised. I'm going to take advantage of today. I'm going to take the opportunity to go for my dreams. I'm going to take the opportunity to be fearless in areas where I'm scared because, hey, I could be scared today, but I may not have the opportunity to not be scared tomorrow. So fuck it. Let me just go for it, you know. The things that I'm stressing and worrying about today, I may not even have to deal with it because I may not wake up tomorrow. So I can't let them it overwhelm me or weigh me down or detour me from any opportunities or, or the space that I need to be in for these opportunities. So it changed my whole outlook on life.
Allen, man, you're an inspiring guy, dude. You got me pumped. You're going to get my audience pumped, too. Yeah, man. Yeah, dude, absolutely. All right, then. Let's talk a little bit about Project Power, or else your team will kill me. Great movie. I saw the trailer. I haven't seen the movie, but I'm excited to see it. It comes out next Friday. Like I said, big-time movie with Jamie Foxx. I've met Jamie. He's a great guy. When he was filming Miami Vice a million years ago. Joseph Gordon-Levitt, cool guy. Tell us about the filming of the movie. Like, was it a good experience?
Yeah, man, it was dope, man. We filmed this movie almost 2 years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah, which is dope. It was last November, we were in New Orleans knocking this project out. I was blessed with the opportunity to join the phenomenal cast. Joseph Gordon-Levitt, I got to play opposite in the film as I played his partner in the as a police officer.
Yeah.
So,
do you take the pill or is that like a spoiler?
Listen, okay. You gotta watch the movie. August 14th on Netflix. It's coming out. Project Power. Right. It's dope, man. Working with a young legend is Joseph. I didn't get the opportunity to work with Jamie, unfortunately. But I know as a film and as a whole, it's incredible. He's leading the show. He's driving the whole film. I'm excited. I haven't seen it as well, so I'm just like everyone else on the 14th. I'm gonna be glued to my seat, with my popcorn ready to rock.
Was the movie supposed to come out in regular theaters and it changed because of Corona, or was it this was always the plan?
I believe it was for Netflix. I don't know.
You don't know those things.
I didn't know those things as far as where they were gonna distribute it, but I knew it was going to be dope, though. The directors, Henry and Ariel, they're dynamic, man.
It looks amazing, dude.
Yeah, they're dynamic. And I'm not surprised when I saw the trailer on how good it was, because those dudes are talented.
Yeah, that movie's going to be trending like in the first 12 hours. I guarantee you.
Everyone's going to be talking about it too. It's perfect timing for it, man. I think films like these sci-fi films, these action hero films, these Marvel films, there's a sense of hope that you get in these films of overcoming these impossible odds, or these big giants, and coming out on the other side. And I think that's exactly what we need right now with the pandemic. Oh, yeah, man. Everybody's psyche is really wild right now. And I think a movie like this would definitely inject some hope and kind of calm the waters a little bit.
Absolutely, man. Wow. You've been so generous with your time, Allen. Let me just finish with a couple of questions. One about your entrepreneurship and one about your foundation. Let's talk about Get It Done Records. Just, great independent roster, man. You have some good stuff. Jay Griffey, Hannah's Field, to name a few. Just some quality people in there, man. Tell me, how long have you been doing this? Is it a lot of work?
I've been doing music for almost 10 years. But the company, we established it 3 years ago. 3 years ago, me and my partner, Trevor, we decided that it was time for us to go out on our own as we were doing music. With another company, and we thought we would be better off independent, and we established Get It Done Records. I can only say enough how much I love my business partner and how hard he works. He is the brainchild behind Get It Done Music. I'm just a pretty face. I'm a pretty face, but as an artist and as a writer, and And as a big brother, I've known him since he was 16, man. So I'm proud to see him as a man grow with him and his family, and be able to grow this business with him. It's dope, man. It's a family business, and we've had the opportunity to work with some big companies from basically every TV show, every network we're doing music with. We're doing all of the sports highlights. Our music is playing on all of those. It's great, and we got a huge announcement. I don't know if I can share yet, but it'll be out in the next couple of days. I believe we signed a huge deal with a major music company. So,
all right, I'll tell you what, this episode is going to go out middle of next week, so maybe you can give us a little, you can talk about it.
I don't know if it's coming out next week.
Okay,
I wish I could give you that. I wish I could.
But, problem.
I gotta ask that, man. They gotta give me some clarification so I can start talking about it. But it's a very big deal for us, man. And I can't say enough how much I'm proud of my business partner Trevor for doing this thing.
Dude, you're an American treasure. So I'm speechless. Let me just leave you off with this question. Talk to us about Demo Nerds, because not only have you done all these things, not only been through all this journey, but you're giving back, man. You're giving back to the youth. Talk to us about Demo Nerds for a minute, man.
Yeah, let's talk about it. Well, Demo Nerds, I established almost 8 years ago. I was pretty down on my luck at that time, but I still wanted to help these kids that my sister's job. She works for a nonprofit where she worked with at-risk youth and foster kids, and foster kids. So I went down there for career day, and I fell in love with these kids. Fell in love with them to the point where I was like, I got to do something for these kids. I want to do something. I want to give them something. So she was like, develop a program. I was like, all right. So I developed a 3-day program where they got to learn acting. They got to develop their short film, and they got to shoot a short film.
Yeah.
And during those 3 days, these kids opened up in ways that their therapist would tell me it took 2 years to get the progress that I was getting with them through the group interaction of them working together to make this film and them starring in the film and performing. And some people that wouldn't even say a word are now the leads of this particular short film. And that process and seeing those kids grow, that's what spawned the foundation. And I've been doing it for a while. I've been so busy the last year or so that I haven't been able to run any camps, but this year I'll definitely, once I get done with this wrestling project, we'll be back at it. But I will like to say, I will also like to say what I'm able to do now, as I've transitioned from not just doing acting stuff. I'm a runner now. Like, I'm a marathon runner.
Oh, nice, nice.
Yeah, yeah, I'm a marathon runner, and that's been a lot of my philanthropy now, is because I have a running crew called Knees Out Coalition. Nice. And running is different. It's not about the mental. It's not about the physical.
It's the mental.
It's about,
right?
The mental health. Yeah. So a lot of our runs and a lot of things that I'm trying to incorporate with running.
Those last 4 or 5 miles are no joke, right? That's all.
Once you get past mile 20, it's another world. But it's not even about just running a marathon, just running for mental health. And that's something that I've established through my running crew Knees Out Coalition. So I have a lot of people that's watching this, if you're a runner or if you're even interested in it, check us out. And or if you're going through a tough time, you got stress, this is what it's about. And this is me. This is what I've been able to do with my available time that I want to continue to give back to people and help people, encourage people to get out there and run, get out there and just get active. And take care of your mental health. And then that goes to your physical. Like, a lot of what we're dealing with is because a lot of people have poor immune system. They haven't been taking care of themselves. They haven't been living a healthy lifestyle. So, so it's kind of my way of giving back the best way I can during this pandemic.
Jesus Christ, man. Dude, you're an American treasure. I think it's a perfect place to leave it, man. Perfect place to leave it. Just listen, you're a modest guy. I'll say it for you. What a guy. What an American treasure, brother. Absolutely, man.
Thank you, man. Thank you.
Yeah, man. Absolutely. And we had a great time. Thank you so much for your time, man.
No problem, man.
Have a great weekend. And everybody, remember, Project Power drops August 14th on Netflix. And listen, like, I'm not kidding here. That movie looks awesome. It looks dope.
Yeah, it does. I'm not saying it just because I'm in it. It does look
good. Yeah, yeah. No, this is no force crap. It's an amazing movie. It's going
to
be awesome.
Yeah, I'm excited to watch it myself. Cool, man.
All right, my brother. Definitely, take care. Brother. Thank you so much for your time, Allen.
No problem. Peace.